So this has now become a question and answer session. So you can ask questions related to the content that was covered as well as lab, whatever questions you have, I'm happy to answer. Yeah.
Good morning, ma'am. Actually, question is related to Wireshark, and basically we are running this Wireshark in Windows-based version. So I want to know that what is the advantage that if you use the TCP dump? Because the packet capturing, this can we can do in
yes.
Window-based GUI and all. Even that ARP request and ARP, this also we can do on command prompt window.
Yeah. So, same point.
But I am saying that whether it is in the main workshop also, we have to do in the same way what you have.
See, it is a question of whatever it is, you be consistent in what you tell your participants. The reason why I said TCP dump, again I'm emphasizing, is in Wireshark when you say capture, it's going to capture a whole bunch of packets, right? And then you have to put a filter where when you sort the packets, you have to specify what the filter is, and then it will sort it and display the select set of filters. That is perfectly fine. If you are comfortable with it, finally what matters is that they evaluate the packet. If they're comfortable with it, that is perfectly fine. As I said, it is, to me, to filter, I somehow find Wireshark filtering to be generally a bit, maybe because I am not that familiar with, because I already learned TCP dump, I know how to filter. I have not learned Wireshark filtering, thereby I don't find it very easy to filter. But if you are starting from scratch and you want to learn how to filter in Wireshark, learn how to filter in Wireshark, specify how to specify host, this number, port, this number, ARP, whatever it is. If you learn it and you convey it to them, fine. That I will leave it up to you as a remote center in charge.
Ma'am, but which will be the more advantageous that I want?
There is a personal preference. I'm sure there are people here who will say, I love Wireshark, I'll do everything in Wireshark. People who will say, I love TCP dump, I'll do everything. It's good to know both tools. It doesn't hurt. You're learning two tools in one shot. So it's... but your personal preference. Finally, what matters is they evaluate the trace. Whatever method you want to follow, you follow. For which you become comfortable, you become familiar, you should know how to filter. Then
I think to install this TCP dump and all these on Ubuntu or this Linux platform, please provide us some guidelines.
Yes, so there will, let's not get into questions about that. There is a specific section where I will specify what exactly do you need to do to conduct the labs in the main workshop. There is a specific, this is on the final day.
Thank you.
Madam, can we show the DHCP packet sitting at the client side?
Huh?
Like DHCP packet capture, can we show?
DHCP?
Dynamic host configuration packet sitting at client side.
Yes, there is an exercise for that also.
Ma'am, we usually say that IP address are logical one because we can change it very easily. It is also true with MAC ID, means we can change the MAC ID. What things happens behind the screen?
Okay. As far as IP address is concerned, it has been designed as that the goal is to change it. The MAC has not been designed. If you are changing it, it is a hack. Or it is something you are not supposed to do, you are doing. So that's the high level thing. IP, when it was designed, people came up with IP addresses, they were supposed to be changed based on location. When people came up with MAC addresses, they are not supposed to be changed based on, they are supposed to be fixed. But it's like a security, you're not supposed to do some things, but people still do it. You're not supposed to steal, people still steal. But it's one of those things. MAC addresses are not supposed to change. But people can hack them for some malicious purposes. Even system administrators may do something like that for valid purposes also. But all I'm saying is, in by default, they're not supposed to change.
What is difference between protocol number and port number? Create confusion with that, some having the protocol number, some not having the, for example, TCP having the 617 port protocol number, I think, and UDP having...
Actually, it's at what layer you're looking at. So protocol number is something that the network layer uses to determine which transport layer process it has to pass the packet to. That is the protocol number. So TCP has 6 and UDP has whatever. ICMP has 1. So whatever are these, this is what the network layer is using to determine which of the other network layer processes, which is ICMP in this case, or the transport layer processes, it has to pass the packet on. Port number is being used by the transport layer to determine which of the application layer. So it's port number is working at the transport layer, protocol number is working at the network layer.
My question is related with forwarding. There are various mechanisms or there are various methods of forwarding, like host specific, network specific, router specific. I know that each and every method has its own advantages and disadvantages. But just to confirm here in the lab session, I just want to confirm whether it's a router-based forwarding mechanism or network-based forwarding scheme. I just want to confirm, like in lab sessions, which method it is useful.
Useful as in there is, so there is something that is implemented. So when you are talking about forwarding, the one that is visible for you as a user is network layer forwarding. Switch layer forwarding you can't even see because it is transparent. It just goes. So let me just, so let's say this is a switch and this is your host that is connected to the switch. This switch in turn is connected to another switch. This in turn is maybe connected to another switch. And here is maybe, let me call it a router that is there. In turn, this is connected to some other. So let's say this is some the way things are set up. Now, when you are sending a packet, right, this destination, let's say it is somewhere this side. Let's say this router is directly, maybe it's connected to a switch, and this is where the host, let me call this host B, and this is host A. Okay, now when host A is sending a packet to host B, what you're going to do is, so the packet that you assemble, as I said, there are, you have to take care of the MAC addresses as well as the IP addresses. So from the MAC perspective, the source is kind of straightforward. You assign your own source MAC address, and the destination MAC address, you are going to assign it to that of this router R. Because as far as you are concerned, these switches are transparent. They are not, they'll just forward internally. But as you see, you're not directly connected to the router. It's going through many switches. Now when this, and as far as the IP address is concerned, with respect to the source, you will put your own IP address, which is corresponding to host A, and the destination will be, let me call this RM to represent the MAC address of R. This one will be B. Now this packet will come through the switch. If the switch knows where this router MAC is, it will directly send like this. Otherwise, it will just broadcast everywhere. Finally, when it broadcasts, it will come to the router. Router will now look at this packet, figure out that it has to go through this destination B, and it knows that this destination B is on this side. So thereby, it will again maybe call ARP, which is again broadcast. It will get the MAC address of B, and it will assemble a packet where on the top is AB, a source and destination at the IP level. At the MAC level, it will put router MAC as the source and B MAC as the destination and send it. And B will get it because this switch, again, if it knows, it will forward, otherwise it will flood everywhere. So that is how things happen, where the network layer is interspersed with link layer in this particular fashion.
Ma'am, my question is related to TCP. Like in heterogeneous networks, suppose multiple senders are communicating with multiple receivers via common bottleneck link, then I believe that my sender window size has to be equivalent to BDP. Is it correct, or it has to be divided by the number of flows? It is, you know, deterministic environment, for example.
So it depends upon how you are defining BDP. BDP is often, yes, ma'am, defined as client specific. It already factors in. So if this bottleneck bandwidth, let's say, is 1 Mbps, right? TCP is, there is some fairness to TCP. It's not perfect fairness. And let's say there are 10 hosts that are sharing this bottleneck bandwidth. Now TCP is there is some fairness to it. So what it will do is this 1 Mbps, it is going to divide by 10. So each is going to get 100 kbps. Now the BDP that you are going to experience through this whatever windowing mechanism will correspond to 100 kbps. So TCP has it factored into the way it operates. So there isn't anything like the BDP is 1 Mbps. BDP is not 1 Mbps. The bottleneck bandwidth is 1 Mbps, but the bandwidth delay product each client sees will be already that factors in the fairness. That will be 100 kbps, which is corresponding to what you should get.
When we set this value, for example, on sender, if my BDP, and let's say I keep this very small, I can exploit the available bandwidth.
Yes.
Right, so what I'm saying is I need to set that value minimum equivalent to BDP.
You have to set it to a value equal to, not, don't call it BDP. BDP, you call it bottleneck bandwidth along the path. Whatever bottleneck, so for example, this tuning of the window size, in a typical setting, it doesn't occur. The default values are what are going to play. But suppose you're using a satellite link where the delays are rather large, then it's important to tune because otherwise you're not going to utilize the bandwidth. So that time, so the tuning should happen with the knowledge, only with the knowledge that you know where the bottleneck is, what you're experiencing, then you should tune. In general, there is no tuning. Typically, for the kind of throughputs that you experience in a typical internet setting, they're already tuned to operate at, they are typically set at a higher value.
Okay.
So and that you can utilize the...
And how queue size will affect the performance in the same scenario? Like queue size on intermediate router where there is a bottleneck, or maybe queue size on each sender?
Yeah. So what is going to happen is, see, TCP, again, if you have gone through the video, it's a very dynamically adaptive protocol. So what it does is, it, as it gets feedback from the network, it is going to adapt its behavior. Really, it's going to change the window size based on, it will increase if there is more bandwidth, it will decrease if there is less bandwidth. So it will adapt to what it is seeing. So currently, if it is able to, its fair share is only 100 kbps, it will start sending data corresponding, the window size it will set such that the delay corresponds roughly to 100 kbps. Now, but if other flows have went away, the queue has become smaller, now you are starting to get 200 kbps, TCP will again adapt, it will increase the window size such that you are able to get 200 kbps. In fact, that is the beauty of TCP. It's a extremely, I mean, each time I look at TCP, I will, TCP is like the, of all the protocols, I have a, it's a personal favorite. So that's a function of TCP, the way it does it. So queuing, so what happens is as congestion sets in, packets will get dropped because queues have overflowed. This is a feedback to the TCP to cut down its window. And as congestion goes away and you're able to, it'll probe through that additive increase to see whether it can get more. So it's a dynamic protocol that automatically manages all these things.
There are two kind of forwarding or routing, that is source-based routing and the destination-based routing. Mm-hmm. I think whatever you explained here, it is a destination-based routing.
That is the default.
Can you show the mechanism how source-based routing is carried out in networks?
Well, source-based routing is not used in the internet. That is why we don't cover much about it. So source-based routing is used in the majority of the internet. We don't use our source-based routing because it's not efficient. It's not just that. It is, you're putting the burden of figuring out the route on the source. And you, people like you and me who have computers, it's not an easy task to figure out what the route is. So source-based routing is used in very specific scenarios, typically by these the ISPs, where they know the path and they kind of know a lot of details, where they will install a source-based thing to, for example, ensure that certain traffic goes along a path and not through some other path because of some competition or because of security concerns or whatever it is. So source-based routing is not often used. It's done just by ISPs in a very specific setting or in the research domain where people, like in ad hoc networks or some, that kind of setups you will see. Internet doesn't use as such source-based routing.
Ma'am, actually I tried number of times to go through this topic, but I was not able to understand the concept of actually forwarding mechanism of source-based routing. I'm clear about this.
Source-based routing is in fact even simpler than this. Or you're specifying the entire path. You're saying that, for example, again, let me...
Is it a strict source routing?
There are two, three... there is loose, whatever. Strict source routing means your packet has to take the entire path that is specified. The non-strict, I don't know what it is called, is where loose source routing is, it has to cover whatever is mentioned, but in between it can take other paths. So I'll probably... Okay, so here is the source, let's say whatever, this is the destination. So this, let me call it R1, R2, R3, R4. Okay, so this is, so when you are specifying to reach destination, you basically specify that this packet has to go through R1, R2, R3, R4. Okay, so when it comes to R1, it knows it has to go to R2 and not this, let me call it X1, X2, X3. It should not go through X1, so it will forward the packet here. R2 knows that it has to go to R3, so it will forward it. It may have other interfaces also, it's not going to send on them. R3 knows it has to go, it will come here. This knows that this is the destination, it will send it here. Now, the strict and loose people have mentioned.
I think it is some kind of virtual connection which we use in frame relay or FDDI networks.
This is no virtual connection. Well, you are insisting that this is the path it has to take. There is no connection set up a priori for this path to take. That is not, that is virtual circuit switching. This is not virtual circuit switching. This is regular routing, except that you are specifying the entire path. So the job of the router in destination-based routing is to look at the routing table. The job of a router in source-based routing is just to look at the header, figure out who is the router, figure out which among the interfaces corresponding to it, and push it out on that.
So how this router R1 will come to know that it have to forward only to the R2, not to the X1 or X2?
This source route is carried in the header of the packet that this guy sends. Yeah. So this source sender that is sending this packet, there is a header field in the packet, right? In the network layer header. In this network like header, you are specifying the path that it take SR1, R2, R3, R4, and D. This entire path is specified as part of the header. So a router just needs, right now a header has only the destination address, which you look on a routing table to forward. That is destination-based routing. Here a router will look at the header, figure out the entire path. It is telling which the next stop is. It doesn't have to consult any routing table. It will just forward based on that. That is source-based routing.
Thank you.
We can consider the MAC addresses. The bunch of MAC addresses are allocated to the different NIC manufacturers. Suppose if I can consider the Cisco, X number of MAC addresses are given to the Cisco, but Cisco is manufacturing more number of NICs compared to only the X numbers. So is it that the Cisco is supplying the same MAC address NIC 1 to the India and same MAC address NIC to US or UK or Australia?
All I know is there are 2 to the power of 48, which is a huge number. You're not going to exhaust that space anytime soon. So there are enough MAC address space. MAC address space is definitely not a problem. So often what is done is each company, so there is the company portion of it, the first 8 bits or whatever is assigned to the different companies. Within that, they can again subdivide it. India may have the next 4 bits, others may have other bits. But what exact mechanisms do these people use to distribute the MAC addresses, I don't know. But scarcity of MAC addresses is not quite there.
Consider they're manufacturing the NIC 80s onward. Then again, the NICs are, life of an NIC is only 3 to 4 years, normal life of an NIC. So again,
even if you use it, 2 to the power of 48 is such a, I think even if you are doing this for the past 100 years or 200 years, it will not be, it's something like, it's a huge number.
Even the total machine over the globe are including the routers and
even
all
then,
the network
machines. Even then, 2 to the power of 48, you do the calculation, 2 to the power of 48 is a huge number. It's like the IP thing when they talk 2 to the power of 128 is, I don't know how much to believe. It's like, since Big Bang theory, the number of milliseconds that has passed is still less than some such statistic is there, madam, with respect to IPv6.
But in this 48, because they have to reuse the same thing.
That is what, do they have to reuse?
The life is less. If I can consider the IP, okay, IP reusability is possible, huh, because it is reconfigurable. But if the manufacturer has manufactured one NIC in 80s, huh, with the address X1, huh, but that life of that particular NIC is not more than 3 to 4 years.
That is fine. But all I'm saying is you worry about the problem when there is address space. I don't think the address space crunch is there yet, because that number is really huge. If it's a smaller number like 16, I would say yes. 32 also fine. But 48 is still, from 30 to 48, I mean, each one is a doubling. You imagine, like, it's a huge number. I don't think that you are going to run out of MAC addresses anytime, not in maybe for the next, maybe I have to do the calculation, but my gut feeling is for the next few generations, you don't have to worry.
Comparing the IPv4 and IPv6 packet format, we are observing that the some portions are not present in the IPv6 packet format. Mm-hmm. Ma'am, is it an advantage or disadvantage comparing with the IPv4 and IPv6? And ma'am, there is another small question, that is it affect the security of the routing protocol for whenever the IPv6 packet formatting is used? Can it affect the secure routing protocol or in the routing protocol? Is it the some fields are not present in the IPv6, and how can we manage the?
So first of all, when people went from IPv4 to IPv6, they know all the troubles of IPv4. So whatever they do, I mean, if they are intelligent people, will be such that it addresses many of the shortcomings of IPv4. And doesn't security by the time is also, people are aware of the kind of secure issues people are facing. So the fields, so IPv6 header is a very streamlined header, and there is a reason why they have removed some of the fields. This is mainly for multiple reasons. So for example, you do not see fragmentation in IPv6. The reason why they have removed fragmentation is it puts additional load on some of these intermediate routers to fragment the packet, and that tends to decrease the speed of the router. So, and it's not a necessary, I mean, then does it mean that there is still a need for fragmentation? In other words, you cannot really say all packets along a path will support the MTU size. That may not be true. But the burden of fragmentation has been pushed to the source. Source has to figure out what is the right fragment to use along a path. And then once it figures out, all the packets will just zip past, because you're not going to do fragmentation as far as the routers are concerned. So it has streamlined some of these things, keeping in mind the capabilities of the routers and so on and so forth. In fact, I would say it has removed a lot of these options. The header also is, options are there, but they have been cleverly designed such that if there are no options, the router is very efficient in reading the header because it's a fixed block. But if there are options there, then it's been designed cleverly that it's a pointer-based system. So it again improves the router processing speed. The way it had happened in IPv4 is if there are options there, you don't know where. I mean, they're spread about. You have to interpret each and everything for you to figure out what it leads to router delay. So all these things are nice features that IPv6 has handled. Now, the question is the compatibility. Now, if you're using IPv6, and if the fact that you have removed some of the fields, what if there is an intermediate router that is IP version 4, and now you have a packet that is IP version 6, now what is to be done about it? So this is the migration issues. So a lot of the migration issues, till the transition has happened, by transition I mean everyone shifting to IPv6 from IPv4, till this transition has happened, a lot of these migration issues are handled a bit manually. In other words, the ISPs, when they change the routers, they tunnel they establish a tunnel, so such that in case there is, so all these are configured specifically, it's not automated where things happen, zip, zip, no, they don't happen. So you ISPs have to configure the routers such that the portions that are handled by RPv4, you kind to tend to put a header, extra header, such that they do, and they do that kind of thing. These are manually configured by ISPs.
Thank you, ma'am.
Can we establish TCP between different subnet?
Different subnets. You can establish TCP within your own host. So there is no question of TCP is just a transport layer mechanism for sending the data. The endpoints can be the same IP address but different port numbers within the same machine. You can establish, for example, within a lab, if you are trying to SSH to your neighboring machine, that SSH is operating over TCP, which means you are establishing TCP between one host and another host that are neighbors as far as the network. You can, this is, when you do socket programming assignment, maybe you will also see, so when you do socket programming for debugging, you don't want to involve another machine because that means traffic has to go. So often you establish the two processes are running on your own machine and they are using TCP to communicate with each other, or sockets, either TCP, UDP, it's up to you, but you can communicate with different processes within the same machine using TCP.
TCP is a connection oriented, so yes. Things, and in the lower layer, network layer, mm-hmm. actually IP datagram packets will be forwarded through different path.
Yes.
I think so. How this connection oriented, we call this connection oriented then?
Okay. So when we say TCP is connection oriented, all it is meaning is before you start sending the data, the both endpoints have to manage their state or exchange their state. So what happens with TCP is, again, so here is a host, let me call it A. It is going through many routers, R1, R2, R3, and here is another host B. And now I'm establishing a TCP connection from A to B. So this is the TCP connection. Now, before sending data on TCP, I am going to exchange some information to B. So I'm going to say, for example, that I can support SAC, or I'm using, so some of these features you can specify, or I'm using this sequence number starting from X. Whatever is this information, this is the state that you're exchanging with B. Only, this is connection oriented. In other words, when you get a packet, you just don't send it off to the other guy, because B, unless the state, it needs to know what sequence number this connection is going to start. All this information it needs before it is ready to receive the data. Connection oriented means this state exchange has to happen before you send the data. Connectionless means you don't maintain any state. First packet comes, push it. Now, if you see, A and B are using this routing infrastructure to exchange this data. So A is going to send this information, B will send, okay, fine, do whatever you want. That kind of exchange happens, then data transfer happens. Now, when you look at the router R1, once it receives this packet corresponding to this A to B, so the source is A, destination is B, and this is the packet, what it is going to do is it will just send it out. It is not establishing a connection with R2 telling, expect this packet from. It is not. It will somehow figure out a path. And it is going to send it out to R2. R2 in turn also will send it out to R6. It will go to B. So connection oriented is in that context. The TCP is exchanging information before it can send the data between A and B. And it doesn't care whether there is one hop, 10 hops, 100 hops in between, because to it, that doesn't matter. For all practical purposes, they are both on the same host also. It doesn't matter as far as TCP is concerned. But it has to exchange this data.
That means two end processes are always ready.
In router, when you do connectionless, connectionless, you are designing the protocol such that you don't have to exchange any data and still act on whatever you are getting. Whereas in TCP, the protocol has been designed such that you have to exchange the data before, exchange some connection state before you can start acting on the functionality. So that is the difference between connection oriented and connectionless.
Ma'am, what is the load balancer and what are the role of the load balancer in transport layer, network layer and the link layer? I give one example for my network. Say I have a lot of lines for the internet. Mm-hmm. I simply connect those lines on a load balancer, mm-hmm. And I simply pass some lines to various networks, mm-hmm. For my network architecture. So how this load balancer works?
So as you pointed out, load balancing can be done at different layers of the protocol stack. It can be even done at application. Most of the load balancing that you see at the server levels is at an application level. So for example, I have a server that is set up, and where there are many connections coming, I'll push some connections onto some other server and some other connections onto another server. They are going to handle. That is server level load balancing.
No, ma'am, that is the application level. Means some load balancer as a hardware. Some load balancer as a hardware which work on the network layer also, ma'am.
Okay, so the network layer load balancing works in this fashion. So for example, so there are two ways to reach a particular. So for example, if you have, when you run the routing protocol, you figure out that you can reach this destination through P1 or P2. Okay, often again the default is this router R will maintain only one entry corresponding to D, which is, it supposes this is going via R2, it will say to reach D send to R2. It typically maintains only one. But if you want to do load balancing, what you can do is when you do this, you may also associate that this path has a cost of let's say 10, and you will say D to reach through R3, this path has a cost of, let's say 20. Okay, now this is a very crucial functionality of the routing protocol. If with this, for example, if you receive, let's say packets, you can decide that since this cost is more, I'll send 80% of the packets on this path, I will send 20% of the packets on this path. You can do something like that. But if your routing protocol is not aware of this, for example, if you are using distance vector kind of a routing protocol, this can lead to routing loops. Because it's a dynamic thing, each one thinks the path on the other side, then you start to looping. But if you're using for example, in ad hoc routing or whatever, where the protocol is not distance vector, but some other version of the protocol, which is load balancing compatible, and you ensure that routing loops do not happen, then what you can potentially do is you can send 80% of the traffic here and send 20% of the traffic here. So that is how load balancing works at the network layer, where if there are multiple paths between the same source destination, depending upon the capabilities of the path, you try to split it.
Ma'am, there are watchguards. Watchguards simply, for example, my network is connected with the proxy server, mm-hmm. and my proxy cannot pass some particular IP. But using a watchguard, I simply pass on those packets which are having the destination of that particular IP which are blocked by the proxy server. Mm-hmm. So how the watchguard work on the network layer, ma'am?
IIT Bombay also, we have this proxy server. And if you want to access certain websites that are restricted, in other words, the proxy will not permit the access to those websites, and you still want to access those websites, so there are some of these some of these other servers you can contact to get that particular content. Is that what you're trying to, which are circumventing the operation of the proxy?
Ma'am, there are two ways. Either I simply put some filter on proxy server, simply filter these packets from the proxy server. But for the same subnet, the subnet is blocked, but for the same subnet, only one particular IP can be allowed to pass the packets. So for this, in our network architecture, administrator simply put one IP, my IP on the watchguard. Watchguard is simply a hardware unit. There simply put some IP, and the packets from my IP pass on through the proxy server.
Okay. So, I mean, I think probably what you are referring to is the firewall rules that, so typically whenever there's a firewall which has been configured, so for example, it may say block all packets coming from, let's say 10.105.*.*, which means everything is blocked. But you can also put an exception saying that the longer prefix, but do not block packets from 10.105.10.11, which may be your IP address. So this is a function of how you set the rules within the firewall to act upon this. I mean, that's an entire so most of the firewall configuration is again a very complicated thing, but it provides a rich set of functionality for you to set rules. So it depends upon how you set the rules within it to implement the required functionality you want. Like, let this traffic pass, don't let that traffic pass. Allow this user, don't allow that user. In fact, you can do it at the user level. You can do it at the IP address level. You can do it at the port level. So there are many things you can set as part of the firewall. But all these are actually going up the protocol stack to the application, which is doing this, looking at all the things, dropping the packets, and then again they go down and go
out. Ma'am, can I identify this with the help of command that particular packet is drop head or drop tail? Ma'am, there are two types of drop head and drop tail in a queue. Then how can I identify with the help of command that this particular packet is at drop head and drop tail?
As such, you cannot. So this is a queue. So a router typically implement drop tail. They don't implement a drop head. Now, if a packet is dropped, you have, unless the router conveys that information to you, in fact, you don't even know where it got dropped. If there is an entire path taking R1, R2, R3, R4, unless R3 tells I dropped your packet through some ICMP message, you cannot even know where your packet got dropped. So that kind of feedback is expecting a lot from the internet, which is best effort, which often doesn't convey this kind of information.